Now let's talk about the respiratory disorder croup. What is croup? Croup is a symptom characterized by infection and inflammation of the upper airway, which is the trachea and larynx. Here on the left, you'll see the normal larynx. There's a normal tracheal opening, and the vocal cords are not swollen. Over on the right, you'll see an inflamed larynx. In the setting of croup, the vocal cords and the surrounding structures cause a narrowing of the trachea, and this causes the symptoms we see in croup. Some children are more prone than others to develop croup symptoms when they get a viral upper respiratory infection, and most outgrow croup by the age of 5 when their airway becomes bigger. Croup is more prevalent in the autumn, winter, and spring, and typically lasts about 1 week. The most common cause of croup are viruses. The parainfluenza viruses types 1 and 3 are responsible for about 80% of cases. Influenza A and B can also cause croup, along with the respiratory syncytial virus, or RSV. The adenovirus and rhinovirus can also cause croup symptoms. Rarely, croup is caused by a bacterial infection, including Staph aureus, Strep pyogenes, Strep pneumoniae, Haemophilus influenza, and M. catarrhalis. First, the infection, which is usually viral, will infect the laryngeal mucosa. Then inflammation, hyperemia, edema, and epithelial necrosis and shedding begin due to the irritation from the virus, and this is going to start the narrowing of the subglottic region. The child will then begin to breathe more rapidly and deeper to compensate for the narrowed airway. The respiratory rate and effort increase in this stage as the patient tries to move the same amount of air through a much smaller space. Next, the patient will develop stridor, which is turbulent airflow. Imagine you're sitting in a cabin in the woods and suddenly a blizzard develops. Near the fireplace, you'll hear a whistling of the air as that turbulent airflow goes down. Well, that's the same thing that happens in the airway, and that's stridor. You can hear it on the other side of the room without a stethoscope. The patient's chest wall will start retracting to try to help the lungs move in more air. Next, the patient will develop asynchronous chest and abdominal movements, and the overuse of these muscles will cause the child to fatigue. This is a very important stage to recognize and intervene before the child fatigues too much. Lastly, hypoxia and hypercapnia will develop, and this can progress to respiratory failure and arrest.